Good evening, sim racing fans. The penultimate race on the iSuperSpeedway.com Racing Series Season 5 schedule brings us into the 2016 racing calendar. We drop six iSuper Chase drivers down to three after tonight. Half of them are going to be going home after the Oatman's Designs 351 as we wrap up Superior 6 round from Talladega. And we want to welcome you topside by myself, Evan Pasoco. Going to be joined alongside by Andy Kessler and Cisco Scaramouza to bring you the call tonight. Laura Lawson's in the truck, somewhat keeping us in line, and she's keeping us live to you as well tonight. We're happy to have you with us on iRacing Live. Josh Hanner just walked away with the Rod Car Truck Tour title just moments ago, but now we transition into our prime time slot. We're ready to get going. These guys have been absolutely bouncing off the walls, Andy, for the last 20 days, having to sit through a couple of off weeks before they can get to tonight. There is tons hanging in the balance. Without a doubt, this is the most important and most crucial race we've seen all season. This is the look at what we're looking at coming into tonight. Christian DePeterson won one race ago. He's into the Supreme Three. Five drivers have a shot to make themselves one of the two drivers that are going to join him.
Yeah, that's the only bad part is we got five guys and two spots to get them in. So there's going to be a lot of pushing and shoving to try to get up in there. The cool thing, though, is it four of the guys have an opportunity for points. One guy, it's pretty much a win and you're in. But that's Josh Ball sitting there in that sixth position. Had a horrible race some 3 weeks ago, I believe it was. So Josh Ball definitely needs to get a win here tonight. If it isn't a win, he better hope he's got some trouble with some of these other guys. But overall, it's going to be a fantastic race to watch with the four guys trying to get in on points and one just trying to flat out win this thing and get an interview with you at the end of it.
That's what everybody's looking forward to. And with that, qualifying draws to a close. No B-Main, no last chance qualifiers tonight. Is the first of the last two endurance races we're going to see on the Season 5 schedule. Our final feature race came those 3 weeks ago for the opening race of this Talladega round, the Superior 6 round. We're getting set to go for the Oatman's Designs 351. It's round 17 on the year. It's iSuper Chase race 4 of 5, and it's round 2 of 2 in the round of 6. And we're happy to have you with us. 82 laps, 219 miles, 315 kilometers set us away from the start to the end of this one, and we'll take it down through the LSRTV starting grid as we get set to get this race underway. Rod Flagg going to start from the top of the pile, a past champion in this series. We'll roll the number 26 Ford Fusion off from the top with a 52.797. He'll pace us around the Talladega Super Speedway as we get set to go. The outside pole going to go to Jason Altman's in the number 51 machine in second. Seth Merchant going to be sitting third on this one. Brandon Chiburco slated to start in fourth at fifth position on the grid to 92. That's Rod Minton.
The 07 Jack Daniels machine that Derek Walker is going to start sixth tonight. Rodney Wofford will start in that seventh position. Outside of row number four will be the one of Chris Bassini, the rookie. I remember that one. Ryan Pyland's going to start ninth here tonight. And rounding out your top 10, that's going to be the 83 of Ramon Evans.
Josh Hanner's going to start right behind him in 11th. 12th's going to go to Glenn Hedrick. 13th to Corey Henry in that 12 machine. James Pulaski is going to start 14th. And Chad Keane's going to roll off 15th in the 96.
And topside to him, you'll find the 64 of Alex Hallinar. 17th is Justin Anderson. 18th for Jeff Figlin. Shane McEachin and Donny Giratano going to make up row 10 in P19 and 20.
21st starting spot will go to the 18 of Jimmy Todd. Kelly Dahl will start 22nd. Row number 12, the inside will be Larry Camp, and outside of him will be Dan Harrington, while Ray Rittenour in the 87 will start 25th.
Ben Niles going to roll off 26th. Dana Osborne going to roll off 27th. Ron Thompson, Ryan Keese will be 28th and 29th. And Frank Basilia is going to roll off 30th.
And 31st, going to be the 48 of Josh Ball, Matt Bontempi, 32nd, 33rd, Tommy Hall, Matt Quick, 34th, and final driver to take a time in qualifying in 35th is Sean Turner. Provisionals will toss him out to Christian DePeterson, Daniel Ferguson, and Kent Connolly. They'll be 36, 37, and 38 on the grid to give us 19 or so rows of drivers that are set to do battle, and we're happy to have you with us. We've done 16 races on this season of five schedule. And it all comes down to this. Christian DePeterson is safe. He's into the next round. Jason Altman's is 8 points above the cut line. Seth the Merchant is 4 above the cut line. If tonight did not exist, those would be the two drivers joining Peterson in the championship. They have to hold off a 4-point gap to Josh Hanner, who's 4 points below the cut line. Wofford tied 4 points back as well. That is 3 to 4 drivers, if you want to throw Altman's into that mix, within 4 to 8 points of each other. It is extremely tight, and in bad news, Josh Ball, the sixth place driver in the standings at the moment, 18 points back, might need a little bit more luck, if not a win, to advance. That's the situation that they find themselves in. They'll have 82 laps to negotiate it around the high banks of the Talladega Super Speedway. And again, we're happy to have you with us on iRacing Live at LSR-TV, the voice of sim racing. We're set to do the Altman's 351. Green flag flies underway from Talladega for the final time in Lincoln, Alabama this season. We take the green flag and power down to turn number one, led by Rod Flagg with a push from the 42 of Seth the Merchant into the corner for the first time, trying to get these guys up to full song already. Shift into fourth gear and up to 170 miles an hour already at a turn number two.
Yeah, Rod Flagg not having the season he wanted this year, and good to see him right there in the pole here for as we're winding down towards the end of the season. So Rod Flagg looking obviously to stay up there all night long and hopefully get a win. Obviously not in the championship hunt this season, but a good starting spot for him and a good spot to be. And now as he pushes way away with a little bit of help from that 42, Seth the Merchant on the bottom. He's got Rod Mitten also in the mix. Just two on the outside. It's that three of Chiburco. He's pushing Jason Altman's now to the line.
And these guys getting squirrely already as a couple of people fan out three wide back in the back, trying to see how all this is going to sort out. And it looks like the inside of the racetrack, the place to be primarily. 2016, new rules, new procedures. We'll have plenty of time to talk in depth about that tonight. The biggest thing to look at as we go on board with the three of Brandon Chiburco Sisco is this is one of our endurance races. But it's not that long of an endurance race. It's much longer than our feature races. It's a big checkup on the inside of the racetrack and to back the 07 up as well, and cost a lot of time to the one of Chris Bassini. Everybody's able to get back straightened out, no problem from that. The big thing is, though, plenty longer than a 40-lap A-Main, but much shorter than some of the races that we've seen in the endurance format. Just 82 laps. It's a lot of time, but not enough time to have any big problems and get back into this race. So these guys are going to have to strike a good balance as at lap number three, Jason Altman's takes over the race lead.
Yeah, Jason had a great run there from the three, Chiburco. Chiburco was able to give him a huge run after that checkup on the bottom. Altman's rode right down on that top side, was able to get the lead, and now it looks like the 26 of Flag, he's going to want to take a look to the lead. Chiburco says, nah, you're on your own, and jumps to the high side. It looks like Flag's going to have a little bit of help, but Chiburco and that 41 machine of Ryan Pyland, those two are going to try and work together. It looks like they might be caught up on the outside. There was a little bit of smoke coming from the 26. A little bit of particle effects. Oh, problems, 26 around.
And Rod Flagg hard into the outside wall. The caution flag will fly at lap number three. He'll roll to a stop. Yellow flag has been displayed, and looks like a couple of guys may have gotten a piece of that as the 26 spun down up against the wall. I think Brandon Chiburco, the 22 of Ron Thompson, maybe the 20 of Appon Tempe, throw him into the mix as well. Those may be the drivers that got a piece of all of that, but the 26 of Rod Flagg, you would have thought that that car lost the left rear tire or something. Unfortunately, Andy, this race is going to be kicked off by a very net code heavy, I guess, accident, if you want to call it that. The 26
like
machine,
it.
Yeah, it works. It looked like the left tire destroyed the car, but I mean, nobody was that close to him, so I don't really think you can blame that on the 92 or anybody.
No, I think he was thinking the same thing, and you know, and from the view in the car, it's hard to tell that, but obviously, if he feels that way in the car, then and we could see that on the screen. That was just, I like that heavy net code. Yeah, that was, that's just horrible. It is what it is. It's what you're going to do when you get 38 cars trying to get on the same exact, you know, server, and you're all trying to link them the same, and somehow it doesn't work that way sometimes in the internet world. So, tough break for Rod Flagg. It's, we talked about it, just a tough season for him all around, and started on the pole, and then to have that happen to him early on in the race, that's just very unfortunate, but sometimes that's just the way the seasons go for you, and you just got to ride them out and hope that the following season's that much better for you. So unfortunate right there, but our first caution here early in this one. Let all these guys with the nerves and the guys trying to get in the championship take a little breather for a moment there before they get back racing.
Yeah, it's going to be a very slow start to this one as we pace just three laps into this one. My concern was looking back there in the pack on where some of our chase guys were going to be. The big name that I would have noticed right away, the 48 machine of Josh Ball, who did not have a good qualifying effort at all. Really doesn't matter. Neither with Tommy Hall. They started 31st and 33rd. They're 12th and 13th after about 7 miles of racing.
Yeah. That makes about a bunch. That figures. Go figure.
if they can keep that pace up, they're going to be in a very good pace to get the night going. But you make up a lot of spots early, you end up in front of where the problem is, and then you get going. The reason I mentioned that, you know, this race is interesting at 82 laps is because of the fact that a lot of the time we'll see people that are in very high-pressure situations. They like to back off. They like to get away from the lead pack. But 82 laps, that's more than doable in a long green flag stretch to go all the way through this one just like that. So I think all of these guys are going to be forced to be aggressive, and well, getting 20 spots in three laps, I think, fits the bill.
Yeah, I mean, we've kind of seen that all season, really. These guys, they love to go out there and race. But, you know, the one person we do have to keep an eye on is that 48. We know he's going out there. He's in take-no-prisoners mode right here. I think that's what we're going to be seeing. He's going to go out there and drive the wheels off that thing, and steering wheel or checkered flag, I think, is what we're going to see out of the 48.
Jason Oatman's, fittingly enough, is going to bring the 51 machine to the race lead. We talked about how he got the push on the outside of the racetrack, eventually went on to the race lead. Well, the 51 machine was in front at the time of the caution flag coming out, so it is Jason Oatman's out in front of the Oatman's Designs 351. So with that being said, he'll lead us back to it. Seth Burchin could be on the outside of the front row. I mean, you talk about big movers. Dan Harrington, 24th to 9th. Dana Osborne, 27th. 7th to 11th. Even inside the top 10, Corey Henry, 13th to 4th. Glenn Hedrick, 12th to 5th. 15th to 6th, if you're Chad Keene. Every time, though, we talk about somebody who has made extreme gains early, that means that somebody did not get the long end of the straw on that one. Those drivers, more in the range of Derek Walker, Chris Pasini, Rod Flaggett as well, Brandon Chiburco, they have not had a good start to their Oatman's Designs 351. But again, there is still so much time in this race, and a lot went down on the pit lane as well. Almost a 50-50 decision with some guys back there coming down to get service. Nonetheless, it is going to be a much different running order as we get set to take the first American Ethanol restart green flag on the evening than what we saw just five laps prior. Slow start, and I think that kind of messes with these guys' psyche a little bit because you just want to get out there and race. And I think that I was expecting an early caution, and again, I know we can't blame anybody for that one with the Netco, but I mean, these guys have been sitting around for 3 weeks, basically, with two Fridays off. It's been 20 days since they were last on track with such the high stakes that a guy like a Josh Hanner or Rodney Wofford or a Josh Ball are looking at being on the outside trying to get in. They know that they're going to have to get a good finish nonetheless. The bad news for Josh Ball is, and even for Hanner and Wofford, is you can do everything you can, and if you win, you move on. That's the only guarantee. But if you finish P2, if you finish P3, and they're one or two spots behind you, or if you're in the case of the 48, where if they don't have a bad night, nothing matters. That's the frustrating part, is you have to have a good night, and they have to have a bad night to make up for the bad night that you had. And, well, we always talk about how these super speedway races are crapshoots, so nothing is a guarantee as we come back and take the green flag for the restart at lap 6, cross it over to lap number 7. We'll see how the next about 75 laps will play out. So we get to back up the speed 2 abreast down to turns number 1 and 2, and a lot of checking up topside. It looked like the 24 machine actually got some damage on the front end and all of that.
I'll tell you what, Evan, I hope that 24 is actually bulletproof right now, because he's on some treacherous water here, running a Clemson paint scheme in Alabama.
And that's dangerous. Man.
Seeing that these two schools are going to be battling out for the national championship here Monday night, I hope that car is bulletproof. I hope he's got tons of security around him, but that's one brave brave driver right there, I'll tell you that.
Well, I know my one of the guys I work with, Bucky Burt, over on Thursday nights on LSR TV2, he's going to be rooting for that car because he's a big Clemson fan. So I just hope he's not at the track, because otherwise, oh, big problems right there. 12 got shuffled out of line. They're going to go 3 wide into 1. That got a little close right there.
Not the first time either. We've seen a big checkup like that. Again, a lot of guys check it up hard. There have been a couple of big rule changes in the last couple of weeks as well. A lot of things considered through all of this is the fact that you are now working with a quick fix, which obviously I have to think changes your mentality. We're back to where we were before we saw those quick fixes taken away. Did see a small decrease in, you know, how all of the caution flags had worked and all of that, but really not a major change. Now it kind of gives you that safety net to go up there, be aggressive, race at the front hard early, and if you get in a problem, not that, you know, you're going to use that quick fix and, you know, just go up there and drive until you wreck every race, but it is there, so it allows you to be in the conversation a little bit more for maybe some guys that would take the more strategical approach. I'm liking what Glenn Hendrick's doing. Look at that top side, the Purolator Chevrolet, bottom the top, looking for the race lead in turn two. The push from behind coming from Seth the Merchant, that's a good guy to have behind you.
It's kind of odd for me to see Purolator on a Chevrolet, Andy. I don't know about that. That's kind of weird,
know, right?
But
yeah, these guys are doing great. I'll tell you what, though. I'm noticing something here, and I'm sure Cisco can comment a little about this more because he drives a little bit more than I do, but these cars seem to have this real unique, like the suck-up is just tremendous on them right now, and it seems to be causing this checkup issue that these guys are having. They get such a huge run on each other that they end up running into each other, like the closing rate. They're just, maybe it's having 2 weeks off or whatever, 3 weeks off, maybe that's why, but it just seems like the closing rate on these cars right now is causing these big checkups, and I have a bad feeling this might cause a huge wreck here.
Well, I think that's part of it. I mean, you know, we did see sort of not really a whole lot done to the draft model with the new build, but I think the rest did kind of, you know, change the mindset, maybe change a little bit of the driving habits on some of these guys, but you know, I think a lot of it's just the case. These cars do have a lot of suck-up, and maybe we don't see that on a week-to-week basis because these guys don't really drive to the point where we really see that. You know what I'm saying? They kind of take it a little bit easier, but right now, someone who's not taking it easier, that 42 at Demergent, he just sent the 22 up to the 21, I should say, up to the high side. Demergent wants to leave this thing from the outside.
And Hendrick made that move topside. It was good, but he did not want to go that high because in that third lane, he's going to go all the way backwards. He's already in 16th position, and he's only been up there for about 10 seconds. He'll get in line behind Kelly Dahl, 17th spot after just the last time we went down the Alabama gang back straightaway. He was in a battle for the race lead. So now that puts the 42 out in front to lead the outside charge. He's got the push from the 12 behind to Corey Henry. Another one of the throwback paint schemes we're seeing in the field tonight. The Hardy Chevrolet just behind to give the push to the Merchant topside. The 51 of Altman's hasn't been all that aggressive. Neither has the 92 or Rodemitten behind him. Those guys on the bottom know that when a challenge comes topside, the 92 is going to get to the bumper, push a little bit more. But the guys on the bottom taking it a lot more easy than the guys topside who are being the aggressors right now.
Now that topside though, Evan, tends to give you that false sense of speed when you're coming off these corners and down the straightaways. You really get that good run, you get the good push. Like right here, Seth the Merchant has the opportunity to drop down in front of Altman's. He's gonna do it right there, so leave Corey Henry out to fend for himself with that topside with Joshua Hanner giving him the push. But it gives you that sense of a lot of speed, so a lot of guys like to run that high side. Plus, it gives you that security of having that extra lane above you that if, you know, your car isn't handling quite right, you do have that kind of safety net, I guess, to move up there. But when you're on that bottom side, you got to be perfect lap after lap after lap in order to keep that thing down there and not get into the guys up above you. So I think taking it easy down there for Jason Altman's, I mean, obviously he's trying to get into the next round of the championship, so he's got to take it easy. He knows he can't have a huge mistake. He's got to finish in the top five here tonight to have a chance.
working lap 13 of the 82 scheduled right now, and the outside, which kind of did not exist in the opening stint of this race, that again was just about three laps. Everybody wanted to jump ship, get to the bottom. The outside was much stronger on this most recent restart. They're starting to lose cars, though, because this lead pack, it is large. It goes all the way back. We mentioned falling to 17th position. It was the car that dropped back a little bit earlier on in this one. At the time, though, battling for the race lead with that number 21 machine. Since Glenn Hendrick has fallen even further back, now he's in 22nd, but he's still in a lead draft. That's 24 cars. 25th on back is the guys that have taken that caution route that we talked about, and that is hanging back, playing it safe early, not being in the conversation up front. That's Chad Keane and James Pulaski in front of it all. I look back and I scan through there, though. No chase names. Your championship drivers aren't going that route tonight. They know that they all need to have good finishes based on how tight the points are. They can't afford to hang back.
Yeah, what a great job right now. Look at Pacini now trying to make that third line go. That's around that 14th, 15th spot right there, right around Josh Ball, who's trying to get a win here tonight. And Josh is definitely starting to, you know, he got himself up to the front from starting 31st, now, you know, riding in that 10th spot right now. But he's kind of in that swarm right now. I think he really, to be comfortable, he needs to be up a little bit further. Maybe if he can get up around that top five area and then kind of get to that bottom line and just kind of ride and keep himself up there, at least until this first round of green flag pit stops that'll be coming up in a little bit. So Josh Ball right now going to look to the bottom side now, drop right in front of Justin Anderson right there. So the top side, oh, now he's going to go back to the top. But now top side, though, only five cars strong, but they're still able to somewhat keep a run right now, at least up to that third spot.
Everybody continues to try to make some moves. It's hard to find help if you don't spawn and start this race really on the grid near your teammate, because you can fight through and try to find some help, but if you don't get there quickly, it's very difficult to find that person that you want to work with. So with that being said, you got to do what you got to do. You got to move around a little bit, but you have to work with who's there. If your teammate is five cars behind you and you can't get to him, you're SOL and you're going to have to work with it. That's what we're seeing right now. Not a lot of the team combinations have found themselves to get hooked up quite yet. It's Corey Edwin Fun. Look at the move by Altmans. He just lost the race lead to the 12-42. He'll jump out now, lead the outside charge. And it was he in the 92 on the bottom, and now it's he in the 92 top side. So he'll have the push from Rod Mitten as they try to return to P1 and 2. They'll be in 3rd and 5th, though, at the start finish on, trying to get back to the race lead. Josh Hanner's number 24 is still on the outside of the racetrack. He's been stuck, though, as the third car in line on the outside. Not sure how much, but it may be some of that damage that's preventing him from really dragging that outside line forward when he becomes the lead car.
I think, I forget which race we talked about it, but I think it was one of the ISSR races, actually, where one of the guys, you know, they had to beat up front of the car and the other guy had to beat up rear of the car, so they just put the two together and that kind of worked. So I think that's kind of what Josh Hanner's seeing. That front nose is a little bit damaged, so he's not going to have the same sort of maybe suck up on these cars, but he has to stay tucked up, but he can't run the motor blow. He can't make the motor blow up, I should say. So he's got to be careful, but you know, I'm looking at that main pack. First car that's starting to sneak in is that mellow yellow machine of Rodney Wofford. He's shown up today and kind of sneaked up like usual he usually does at these races. He's kind of made his way. Now he's going to take a look to the high side. Just as I say, looks like he wants to lead this thing.
And he's going to be digging, and we mentioned a couple of throwback paint schemes as well on board that number 7 mellow yellow Chevy, Rodney Wofford. He's got the push on the outside of the racetrack. The 12 of Cordy Henry having a couple of connection issues, leading the race on the bottom. Looks like it'll clear up enough before it causes any major problem. Everybody going to go to the inside of the racetrack. That's the 83 of Ramon Evans. So we've been green for about 10 laps after that caution. That's all it takes for when you lose the lead draft to get lapped. That's what happened to Ramon Evans. He'll fall one lap to the negative. Everybody else, it appears that they continue to sit in their packs and they're safe. That secondary pack, though, has really absolutely fallen off the deep end in the last 10 laps. They've gone from being 4 to 5 seconds behind to now 14 seconds back. 30th through 36th is that additional 7-car pack, but your lead lap pack now still sits strong at 26 total cars within 1.5 seconds of each other. Back half single file, but the top 10, 15 guys have not really single filed out all race. The outside still looking pretty sharp despite a new build and a new setup. Demerjic gonna try out the outside this time. He wants to go back to the race lead, a big push out of turn four.
That's a great one right there with that veteran Rodney Wofford giving you a push like that. That's a good thing right there. It's going to push the Merchant though down to the bottom. Wofford's going to continue on the high side with a pretty good momentum right there. Altman's right on his rear bumper trying to give him a push. Top four now side by side right now off of turn number two. And pretty interesting. Kind of seen it in the pack really fan out too also as this run goes on. These tires start to wear out. You see him going three wide a little bit further in the pack, but there it is. Wofford now to the lead with the push from Altman's, and that's a familiar place. We always see that seven up front leading some laps here at any of these super speedways, and just one of those guys that just knows how to get it done.
Close call back there on about row 5, 6, or 7, right in that middle of the pack area. A little bit of a bobble, and 3 wide we go. The guy out of line, Shane McEachin, he's not going to find any help in the Husky Tools Toyota. He'll have to drop back in line behind Peterson. Can't do it. Here comes the 20 car. Not going to let that gap close, so Matt Bontempi going to work his way back through. And now with the 22, the 41, and the 96 coming into the picture, things got a lot worse for Shane McEachin because he's going to continue to slip backwards until he can find a spot in line. Now 20 laps in, though. Many of these guys, 21 laps in on tires. About, I'd say, maybe a third of them came down to the pit lane under that first and early caution flag. And this, we're starting to see the handling go away on these race cars. They're out there at 109 degrees Fahrenheit of asphalt. These tires are starting to give up. The car is starting to get tight. And everybody's starting to move around a whole lot more.
Yeah, and they've been mentioning it on the radios a little bit, been standing the radio chatter during the race. A couple cars up there have been, you know, a little blink tonight, a little bit of blink, maybe some net code, a little bit, you know, obviously iRacing hasn't had the greatest luck as of late with a lot of their server stuff, so maybe a little bit of connection issues for some of our leaders here. We keep seeing that 12 blink in and out of your picture there, not a whole lot, but I gotta wonder, here comes that 71 car. It's, you know, it's about that time of the run where he usually shows up, and I believe he pit on that first caution, and that might be the way to go here. Is, you know, with the 71 here also comes the 48 of Josh Ball, who's also got to be up there. So we're kind of seeing how DW usually says the cream always rises to the top, and these are the guys who need to be up here.
3 wide again we go, and this time it's Alex Hallinar who's going to be the odd man out. Again, the cars, they just push up, and especially in the tri-oval, we're seeing it as well as in and off the corners, but the tri-oval is a very bumpy spot on track, which you don't really think about. 3 wide, the 96, the 64, that's contact between the 96 of Keene and the 64 of Hallinar. I believe it was the inside of the racetrack, the 8 of Osborne, but it pushed up a little bit. But that's what's happening, is that these cars start to move around a lot more. It's harder to keep them closer together, and when you're moving around a lot more, staying closer together is not a good idea, because a little bit of movement can really send somebody out of whack. But we're starting to get to the part in the run where it's really turning into a crapshoot now, and those guys that we talked about picking up a lot of spots in one dose early on, they're starting to enjoy that now because it's getting really dangerous around row 5.
Yeah, you see the tires wear off, they start pushing up in the corner, especially at the bottom. And that's kind of what we were talking about a little bit earlier on, that being on the bottom, you've got to be pretty much perfect because you don't have no wiggle room as far as if you get tight pushing up, you end up pushing up in those cars on the outside. And that's typically how we end up seeing the big wrecks here right now. But look at that outside lane right now, a little bit of push right there from Peterson, giving it to the 24. I don't think you'll hear anyone cheer when that 24 gets to the lead, but you might hear a lot of boos.
They were wrong place for that as well, and it's a combination of the 24 at Talladega and the paint scheme probably not working in Josh Hanner's favor. He'll hold the Rodcar Truck Tour Championship trophy out the window. Might want to bring the arm back in. He might get door slammed. The 71 topside Peterson got knocked out of line. Altman's got a little bit of a lake behind, and now we go three wide, except two guys wanted to go to that third lane. Here comes the 41 of Ryan Pyland. He's coming with the 48 of Josh Ball. Ball catches the fence that time at a two. That's going to stall the momentum out for that third lane, basically kill that third lane, and that leaves Ryan Pyland out there up the creek without a paddle, so he'll fall back down. But just like that, we just started to calm things back down. It all broke open, two wide, now eight rows deep in turns three and four.
And out of all of that, the 42 has somehow got the leads. We're seeing cars start to hit pit road. I think the tightness is starting to get to some of these guys, and maybe a little strategy call on the fuel. But that 24 has made it up to second place. But don't look now. Seth the Merchant, he's run first, and his teammate, Kristen Peterson, he's run about third. He's run third in line, but he's starting to slide back now. Not a lot of help on that outside. But once those two find each other, we're in for some big... Everyone else is in for some big trouble, because once those two start running together, it's really hard to separate them.
I can't promise that surging is the right word, but it's kind of what it looks like. We all group up and then we string back out. We group up and we string back out, and that was every hole. But again, we talked about at lap 26 with the limited fuel cell that these drivers are running. Per the league rules, it's 70% that puts us right on the window for some pit stops, and that's why everybody was single filing out. So Seth the Merchant, he will not come down. Hanners, and look at the 64. Alex Hallinar not going to make it onto the pit lane. He'll take the Danica Patrick line into the grass. More problems for the 51. Jason Altman's doesn't make the cut, and I believe Josh Hanner took out the cone. That'll be close to a penalty as well. Calamity trying to get them all slowed down to just the pit lane speed when you're talking about going 200 plus miles an hour in turn four. Trying to get them down to 60 is not as easy as it might sound.
No, and that's exactly what we talk about it week after week after week at these restrictor plate races. A good way to lose these things is to have problems on pit road, at pit road entrance, speeding, sliding through your box like the 24 just did on his stop. So for guys that are wanting to get you know themselves in the next round of the chase, pit road is a huge factor in today's race. And right there, already on the first stop, we already see some trouble for a lot of these guys. It looks like the 24 didn't receive a penalty, but I'm not sure about some of those other guns like Jason Altman's.
We'll wait to see if they get any penalties assessed, and at Talladega, that drops you out of the pack, and that basically sends you in unless you can get a caution to flag quickly after you get back out on track. I mentioned Seth the Merchant had stayed out. The number 42 machine has since come down, gotten service done on that car. He came down, no surprise, with his teammate Kristen Peterson, which is evidently what he was waiting on. So he's got service done and wrapped up. It puts Justin Anderson to the race lead, along with Ryan Pyland, Matt Quick, Frank Cilia, and James Pileski, along with Shane McEachin, the top six drivers, all in one pack, and a turn number four. Those are the six that we await to come down to the pit lane and get serviced. And then as well, the pack that you were originally talking about being almost 20 seconds back, that includes 7th through 13th and 14th right now, all the way Sean Turner back to Ryan Keyes. Then you find your would-be race leaders in 15th position. Seth the Merchant would take over the race lead when all of this cycles out. But in the meantime, 14 drivers still have to come down to the pit lane. A lot of them going to come down this time. And again, a lot of contact off turn four.
Yeah, it's getting really dicey, and one of the things I'm noticing, both the guys who are coming down and the guys leaving pit road are having a lot of trouble getting in and out of pit road. And, you know, we talk about that new build, obviously with the whole marbles effect now in effect, really. It looks like, I don't know what the problem is, but I saw Rodney Wofford do it off of pit road, but a lot of these guys are just spinning their tires. They're having a lot of trouble getting off pit road. Maybe it's due to that, you know, extended vacation we kind of had there, but... You know, it's really odd because I haven't really seen this out of these guys.
It's always a little bit hairy, but tonight things not orderly. It's not a normal night, though. There's so much pressure, Andy. It's funny because we talk about as more guys come pit side this time. Justin Anderson, not one of those drivers, though, that's going to come down and get serviced. We talk about how sometimes when you try to be careful, you're almost not... I mean, you almost hurt yourself because you try to take it a little bit easier than you normally would, and you end up actually making more mistakes than if you just did what you do every week.
Yeah, that is one of those huge things. When you try to go against your better judgment or go against the norm, that is when you tend to make some mistakes. So You know what? It's got to be nerves for a lot of these guys. The pressure to make it into the next round and you know, just being that close to an opportunity to possibly win a championship. I mean, it's exactly what you these guys do this for. You know, you're here to win championships and here to win races. So I got to say the pressure's probably a little bit for some of these guys, plus a little bit of rust. I mean, talk about 20 days since the last time we got out. That's 3 weeks. I mean, that's just unbelievable time in between races. And obviously you can't control that because of the way the holidays fell this year. But it is what it is. So I'm not surprised seeing some of the mistakes that we've seen out here. But, you know, these guys are professional. They'll get it done and they'll figure it out and they'll get back into the swing of things. And the second half of the race should be fantastic.
More leaders coming down pit side. James Pileski, Ryan Pyland are in for service, as well as Shane McEachin and Frank Basilia. So that should, I believe, round out most of the pit stops that were still awaiting to get completed. The only two drivers that are still out on track, Justin Anderson, started 17th. He's your current race leader. Matt Quick behind him in the number 89. Both of those machines came down to the pit lane under the opening caution flag, so they have a little bit of extra fuel. I wouldn't expect them to be staying out, though, any much so longer, and it looks like they're both going to duck down pit side that time at a turn number 4. They'll be joined by Daniel Ferguson, and although they squeeze the tires a little bit and lock them up, it looks like all three of those drivers are able to get down to the pit lane safely enough. And what that means is when we all cycle back through, as guys get back up to speed, it's going to be the 42 of Seth the Merchant and the 71 of Christian Peterson, P1 and P2. We were just talking about how if you can't find your teammate, you got to figure it out nonetheless. Well, those guys know good, or they're really good at finding each other, rather, and they did that right there. That 42 machine stayed out one extra lap when everybody else around them came down. It paid off because those two cars right now are going to be running P1 and P2 when they cross the stripe.
And we're just seeing the top four in that group who are going to eventually become our race leaders here. Top four of those guys are all chasers. Two chasers not really in this pack is that 51 Altman's and the 24 of Hanner. And those two, Hanner's kind of tagged on to the second group that's kind of behind them. But Altman's, I'm having to tap through the field. It's taking me a while to find him. I found him back in 24th now, but he's way back there. He does not want to be back there.
I think that mistake on pit roads would cost him, honestly. And it just shows you a mistake on pit road can cost you a lot of time here at the Super Speedways.
Yeah, we always talk about how much it hurts to lose spots or really just have a problem on pit road. Under green versus under yellow. Under yellow, it costs you spots, but under green, it costs you time. You can make up spots. You can't make up time by yourself, though, at a plate track. That's not how it works. So that's going to put you in a sticky spot. And really, you know, for those guys that, I mean, blew their pit road entry and had to go all the way back around to come back in, or for those that had to serve speeding penalties, that really screws you. If you can find somebody else there to draft with, you'll be somewhat, competitive in a two-car draft, but nowhere near as fast as a pack of 15 to 20 cars. So you're going to be slowly losing time. All of those drivers are going to be okay if we have a caution. That's what we're banking on. The drivers that are enjoying what they're seeing right now are out in front of the field. And it's Shane McEachin and Frank Basilia III with the pit strategy. They came down, elected to not take as much service on the pit lane as when everybody else had. They are running right now P1 and P2. It's a good idea, but here comes everybody else. And here comes Seth the Merchant and Christian Peterson with a huge head of steam to the start-finish line. It would have been a whale of a finish at the line. McEachin held on, but topside for the Merchant going to be enough to put him now officially to the top spot back at lap 35.
Yeah, that was like, that was just an incredible run. That just shows you that the six cars that were in a line were that much faster than two. So it's just amazing how it works, you know, when you can't really tell, you know, when you were looking at them on the track, they're all running 190 miles an hour, 95, 98, you know, and you look at them on the track, you're like, oh, those guys are going pretty fast. Oh, that little group's going pretty fast. And then when you see them start to catch up to each other and you see how fast they blow by them, it's just amazing. It's just flat out amazing. They all look like they're going the same speed, but when you get them in the packs, start catching each other. It's just pretty cool. But then, you know what? And then now you look at them now. You got eight cars right up here in this front group. And once all those cars got around them, then the other two, the Shane McEachin and Frank Basilia, we're able to just basically blend right in. So it doesn't take much with the draft to get these guys all back up to the same speed right now. But the problem is you split up Seth the Merchant and Christian Peterson. Peterson doing everything he can with a little side draft action right there going into turn number three to get back up there with his teammate.
Just five laps shy of the halfway point at the Talladega Super Speedway with Seth the Merchant back out in front. And again, because of the limited fuel cell, which is the reason why we've already seen pit stops at Talladega, means that just as everybody else gets back out there and gets kind of formed back up at a lead pack now, though, that is only at eight cars strong. Ninth through 16th are 7 seconds back at a couple more packs from there on through all the way to 33 drivers on the lead lap. Pit stop round number two is really not all that far away from us at this moment, but a 42 machine at least in control at the moment at Talladega. We'll step away, go LSR-TV nonstop in just a moment. The 42 leads at the moment at Talladega. You're watching the Oatman's Designs 351 on LSR-TV and iRacing Live. Back in a moment as we continue to watch our coverage of the iSuper Chase Superior 6 round. We're back live at the virtual Talladega Super Speedway, getting things back underway. And as we continue to roll now, closing in on the halfway point, little big bobble, the 71 of Christian Peterson. We have been talking about how he has been working with Seth the Merchant. He kind of got bumped out of line and tried to get back in line. A close call there, not able to find a spot between Frank Basilia and Josh Ball. The 48, though, at the moment, one of your best running chase competitors, and for having the biggest deficit to overcome, he's doing exactly what he needs to do. But because the rest of his chase competitors aren't having terrible races, P4 still might not even be enough. He's got plenty of time to work on it. This time by will take 42 laps to go. The next time by will be halfway done and halfway to go, but he's got a little bit further he's still going to get. But now, all of a sudden, we were talking about how crazy things were, guys, at lap 25 and 30. Now that we've gotten spread out after a wild round of green flag pit stops, this race has really settled down and looks like it could take a green flag look to it.
Yeah, and you also look around. A big part of that is just because we're in all these little packs because they got spread around. You know, you got the lead pack that's eight cars. You got about another eight cars in the second pack. And, you know, it just keeps getting spread out further and further like that. And you see that all around the racetrack. So when you get that happening at a super speedway, the only thing that's really going to throw a caution out is if one of these packs, when they come down pit road, they have issues and end up taking each other out. But, It's one of them things, you know, these top eight guys here, they don't want to see a caution. They want it to stay exactly like it is. It takes a lot of pressure off when it's only, eight of them sitting in a line, you know, battling for the positions. Where they're right now, you know, currently we don't see a lot of jockeying around for position. We just see a lot of riding, just logging laps and waiting for that one more pit stop they have to make before the end of this. So, for these guys, they want to keep it green. They want to be able to settle this out amongst themselves, and they know that a caution is just going to bring 20-something other cars back into the picture and could really mess up their chances, especially seeing that four of the six guys that are battling for the championship or to get into that last round are right there in that eight car pack there for the lead. So guys like Josh Ball, who have to win here tonight, that's right where he needs to be, is having an opportunity to win. Wofford, who's sitting on the outside looking in just by a couple points, he's doing everything right now. Obviously, Peterson's already in his set, the merchant. He obviously wants a win to get into the next round. Doesn't need it, but he needs to be where he is right now. So all these guys right now in the front, they want it to just stay like it is, let themselves battle it out for those three positions. But anything can happen. It's super speedway racing, so we'll see what happens here in the second half of this race.
And we mentioned where some of them run as far as our chase competitors. Well, we are past the halfway point in the Altman's Designs 351. Let's take a look at our LSR TV mid-race leaderboard presented by iRacing.com, the leader in motorsport simulations and the official sim racing partner of NASCAR. Shane McEachin leads at lap 43 of 82 out in front of the field after starting in 19th position. The guy that started inside to row two in third finds himself in second. That is Seth the Merchant, who enters tonight 4 points above the cut line in the iSuper Chase bracket. Behind him, Frank Wasilia from 30th to 3rd. Josh Ball, 31st to 4th. And Big King put up the 48 machine, 18 points behind the cut line. I think he feels like he needs a win if he wants to get to the next round. Running 4th at NP5 behind him is Ron Thompson. Rodney Wofford is sitting in an interesting spot. He's 4 points below the cut line. He runs in P6 at the moment. Chris Pacini in 7th. Christian Peterson at 8th position. Peterson already locked in to the Supreme 3. Behind him, you'll find the 82 and Dan Harrington. And to round out our top 10, back in the second pack, that's about 8 seconds behind your top 8 drivers, is Kelly Dahl.
Yeah, Jeff Biglin right now in the 38. He's running in that 11th position. 12th right now, it belongs to Donnie Giratano. The 13th spot with Justin Anderson. Josh Hanner, one of those guys that really needs a win and a solid run, he's sitting 14th in that second pack right now. The 89 of Matt Quick sits 15th. 16th is James Pileski. Ryan Pyland is in the 17th spot. 18th right now is Rod Mitten. 19th place goes to the 96 of Chad Keane. Jason Altman's another one of those guys battling to get into the Supreme 3, is rounds out the top quarter.
21st is going to go to Dana Osborne, who's kind of holding on to the back of Altman's and Keane there. They're kind of in a pack on their own. Glenn Hedrick leading another pack there. That's the guys, I think, who stayed out a little later. He's run 22nd, 23rd to Matt Bontempi, 24th to Brandon Chiburco, 25th to Sean Turner. Jimmy Todd's run 26th, 27th to Derek Walker. The 088 of Ken Connolly's run 28th. 29th is going to go to Ray Rittenour. He's your last car on the lead lap. And 30th is going to go to Rod Flagg.
And then the rest of the drivers battling with Flagg, trying to get in that lucky knock spot that also sit one lap down, including Corey Henry, Ben Mile, Alex Hallinar, Ryan Keyes, Daniel Ferguson, and Tommy Hall, 3P36. Two laps down in 37th is Rowan Evans, and in 38th position, the only driver so far tonight to appear to be not making it to the end of this one, Larry Camp, still sitting in his pit stall getting serviced, rounds out your field of what is a total of 38 drivers at the halfway point. It's calm again. We have let you know where all of the chase drivers run. Really, we wait for the next big move to come. A caution would evidently and no doubt bring that, but it looks like the guys up front, and we talked about how in their own scenarios, they're doing fairly well. They're all fairly comfortable with their city right now, especially if we're talking about chase guys and everybody else looking for a win inside of that lead pack of the top eight cars. But if you're not in the top eight, you're going to have to start to get frustrated, because P9 on back, they were about 6 or 7 seconds, I think, right when we came out of the gates off of pit stop, Cisco. Now they're almost 9 seconds back, and they're running side by side at the moment. So with these guys kind of battling with each other, slowing them down a little bit, they're not catching our leaders. I don't really see them making up 9 seconds under green flag throughout the rest of this race. They're kind of stuck where they are right now. Even worse so for the guys 16th on back, because then you start talking about 25, 30, 35 seconds and more off of the guys up front.
Yeah, and I hate to break it to those guys, but 25, 30 seconds, Talladega, no, it's not happening. Yeah, it's such a big gap here, especially at a track like this, where you don't really have, you know, the fall off. You would see it like a mile and a half. And obviously these leaders are seeing a little bit of shuffling now as a lap car. Looks like the 71 of Peterson's going to take you to the outside. But question I have is, how long does Josh Ball wait? because you know he's got to get up there. He's basically in a position, the way they're running right now, he needs to win. Yeah, it's basically where he's at right now because, you know, we have the 42, the 7. They're all running up here, which means, you know, they're way ahead of him in points, which means he'll probably make it in as they stand right now. Josh Ball needs to win this race. So how long before he makes his move? I guess we'll find out. Maybe if they make one more pit stop, it'll probably be after that. But if they're good to the end, then we probably will see it pretty soon.
I think they were going to have to come down pit lane one more time, which, I mean, it wouldn't be out of the realm of possibility to try to gain some spots now and then come down to the pit lane. But I think the 48 machine, he's just trying to get to the next cycle of pit stops, get down to the pit lane, get serviced, and then he'll deal with the rest. Look at topside, though. They're no longer all single file. Christian Pedersen with the push from the 26 Rod flying into 12 behind him. Ron Thompson is actually on the bottom. That's the 12 topside working with these guys. Actually in a position that's interesting. Rod Flag, 26, is a lap machine. The 12 machine of Corey Henry is a lap machine. They're 30th and 31st. Those are the first two drivers, one lap to the negative. So Rod Flag's the lucky dog. The 12 machine, if a caution comes out, he gets nothing. So those are two guys that are fighting with the leaders because they both want to pass the leaders, get back to the lead lap together, but they're in this mix with the lead lap cars. They can race there, and they have a lot of incentive to do so, but as a lead lap car, that's what always makes me nervous when you got lap machines intertwined in the pack with you.
That's... It's different, though, when at a super speedway, when you got lap down cars, it's not like they're slower. They're obviously keep up with you. It's different when you're at a mile and a half track. You got the lap traffic that may be damaged or a little bit slower. And when they're mixed around with the leaders, that's when it usually causes for some mayhem. But these guys obviously still have the speed. They're able to hang with these guys. So really, when you're thinking about it, you are these guys in that front pack. You're just looking at them as other cars to race with, not really that they're a lap down.
And they're staying up at a high side too. They're not forcing the issue, but actually Christian Pedersen, which was the lead lap driver in that mix, he elects to go to the bottom of the racetrack and they fan back out a little bit. So at 32 laps to go now, starting to think of, you're in the window where you can now pit, I think, and be good to the end. There's a lot of smoke in turns 3 and 4. Big problems for Derek Walker. The City Chevrolet is slow on the apron in turn number 3. He had a self-spin accident. No, he was in a pack in P28, running in about 25 seconds or so, I'd say, behind your leaders. He got into contact with a couple of guys. Heavy damage on Walker. He'll be forced down to the pit lane. Oh, contact, guys, coming pit side. Everybody's going to scramble and shoot different directions as they tried to pit with Derek Walker slow on the apron. I'd say at least 3 guys got damage.
Yeah, that got all shuffled up right there with that big pack coming in. That was Josh Hanner was in that, though, and that's important because, you know, he's a chaser right now. He does not need that.
Kelly Dahl got some damage. The problem is you think, well, how do you not see him? Caution flag now comes out, though. So the yellow will fly at lap 52, and we'll try to put a number on this one. It may be problems for Jason Altman's. The number 51 machine was leading this race earlier on, and he ended up out in the grass. But the spin is going to come from the 3 of Brandon Chiburco, and he was coming down to the pit lane in a group of cars. And when they all came down pit side, it looked like he got a little bit tight on the brakes. He actually broke sideways, and then he got hit in the right rear by the 36, who I don't think was coming down to the pit lane, Andy. There's a lot of room on that apron, but these guys like to, I guess, take a very wide arc onto the pit lane. And Sean Turner just nicked Chiburco, spun the 3 car around. And now you have a really interesting scenario on fuel where you had half the guys on pit road, half the guys off pit road. I really don't know who's going to end up where.
Yeah, the replay's on your screen right there and just flat out ran out of room. The 36 just wanted to stay with the draft of those guys that were in that group that were staying out. So, that's why he was so low and didn't give much room to the 3 right there, but just a little bit of contact. Fortunate for Chiburco when he came back up the racetrack, there wasn't more cars coming, so he was able to avoid anything further than that than a little bit of right rear damage. So should be able to get that fixed on pit road, but this is definitely going to shake things up. Obviously, the guys that did come down pit road don't have to stop again now. They will probably assume the lead as the leaders, Shane McEachin, and the rest of them head down pit road.
Pit side we go. Shane McEachin going to be the first driver in. He'll go to pit stall number 19. Basilia already stopping before him in second spot. And the only driver to bring us all the way down, Seth the Merchant, to pit stall number 3. I would assume 4 tires in fuel.
Yeah, the way we've seen the handling, we saw it in that first run there. They're all in a pack. The guys who stayed out after that first caution, it looked like some of them were having a little bit of trouble. And it looks like, actually, we have a problem right now on pit road. Brandon Jaberko is stopped on pit road. It looks like he might have lost the motor. He can't get to his pit stall. And that's something these guys will have to avoid because I think he's solid. Which, you know, on iRacing, it looks like the 41, actually, of Ryan Pyland, he's going to get stuck behind. No, he's going to push Jaberko to his pit stall. But, you know, for those of you who have used the sim, you'll know this, but pit road is usually transparent once you go inside the box, but for Brandon Jaberko, he was stuck there and a bit of a roadblock for some of these guys.
He was outside of that concrete area where the stalls are, so that's a solid object. If you run into him, he's going to be able to get pushed down and out of the way, so he's no longer a factor in this race, which is good, or rather in the way of that pit lane. So he's not going to affect anybody else getting off of the pit lane. It was dangerous, though, because he was coasting in when everybody else was coming down. That doesn't help his chances of trying to be in a good spot because he's one lap to the negative at least, and he'll probably be a couple of cars deep in that window as we look forward. The good news for your race leaders is they didn't come down pit road quite yet. It's good and bad. They stayed out, so they're going to get their service done, and they're going to continue to lead this race. Even though this is kind of a bad break for those guys that were deep in the pack as far as guys that had already pitted, guys that were laps down, they stay out now. They're going to get the wave by, and you're no longer 25 and 30 seconds off, Andy. This is now a brand new race. It's like an A-Main now. You got 30 laps to get the job done. What's happened in the previous 54 is basically irrelevant.
Yeah, and this is, like I said, this is what the guys running that top eight didn't want. Seth the Merchant, Josh Ball, the 7 of Rodney Wofford. Those are the guys that fortunate to have themselves in that top eight there, and they were able to, you know, to close the thing out, hopefully, is what they were hoping, and battle amongst themselves for those last three positions. But now, since the caution, it's going to bunch everybody right back up together, and it's just going to give everybody, all 36 cars or so that will probably, well, at least 30 right now are showing on the lead lap. Now you're giving 30 guys another shot at this thing to pull out a victory, and you're giving those guys that were outside of that group that were battling for this championship, like the 51 of Jason Altman's, an opportunity now to get themselves back up in this and an opportunity to get into that Superior 3.
Well, Andy, you talk about us. We're going to take a look at the chase grid right now. That's coming up on your screen. But I have to pose this question to you, Andy, because I was thinking about it kind of as we were running there. Josh Ball, it's a completely different race for him now. You know, before he was running in an eight-car pack, obviously, you know Seth the Merchant and Christian Peterson are going to work together. And, you know, Wofford might be able to help you out if you're Josh Ball. Does this maybe help him a little bit? Because now he has the cars. He has enough cars that if he makes a run on the outside, I think he can get it done. So this might actually be a benefit for the 48 because he has a lot more traffic now. This means a lot more passing, and he may be able to get out from behind, you know, to Merchant and Peterson, and maybe be able to find a little bit more help now.
Yeah, there's definitely more opportunity for him to find a dancing partner to get himself up to the front. But I really think that there was enough cars there, and guys like Wofford, who, you know, even though doesn't quite need a win, he would still probably push him up to the front. So it probably is a good opportunity for him to have more help from other guys, but it's also an opportunity for him to, you know, get caught on three wide on the outside and get shuffled back to 30th. So for him, he's going to restart third. I really think that for Josh Ball, at least for the next, you know, 10 to 15 laps, he's really got to just protect that bottom side down there. And I'm sure Evan would agree, just to keep himself up to the front. And hopefully he doesn't lose too many positions by doing that, you know, and then worry about it in the last 10 or 15 laps to battle for the win and go for the win.
I'll agree that the caution's good for him, which, you know, I'll take 8 cars over having to deal with 30 any day, but the problem is we're not talking about guys earlier in the rounds. We saw the chase grid. You're looking at the Supreme 3, but there's only 2 spots left. Peterson's already in. You've got Altman's and Demerchant in into tonight, and Jason Altman's night has gone downhill very quickly after having a very good start to it. He's back in 23rd. But you look at a guy like Seth DeMerchant's up there, Rodney Wofford's up there, and I'm thinking, you know, when we were talking about in the round of, or going into this round of 6 and a round of 10, there were times we talked about the controversy at Daytona, how a lot can happen, but everybody gets in. So I'm thinking, okay, well, if Josh Ball gets the win, but nobody's going to let that 48 win because it would then knock them out. There's no compromise amongst those 8 drivers. So I think that that 48 is going to have to utilize the surplus of cars that they're now going to have around him to get something done. I can promise you, though, that they're not going to make it easy because the fact that Christian Peterson's in means that he is going to work with Seth the Merchant and against Josh Ball. So there's no compromise amongst the guys that are trying to get. There's only 2 spots open if you want to fight for a championship, but 5 drivers are trying to fit in those spots.
Well, you're absolutely right. Obviously, we'll see how things shake out here on the restart. Here's the pace car hits to pit road. A long stretch to get to that go zone for Seth the Merchant. He's going to get the green flag along with Shane McEachin on that bottom side there. Green flag back in the air, and for Josh Ball, this is it. It's go or go home now for him. And he's sitting in that 3rd spot on the restart. Pretty good jump by both lines there. A little bit of a lag down in the back there around the 12th, 13th position there. A pretty big gap there behind the 24, Josh Hanner. But that bottom side right now, currently off of turn number 2. 2 cars now out to the lead. It's a battle for the 3rd spot.
And it's 2 car length, maybe 2.5 advantage to the bottom. The outside is going to make an appearance at Frank Massilia the 3rd, and it's to Merchant up there. The 71 can't quite get to the 42 yet. You see, he's trying to stick that 22 of Thompson up out of line, tried to peek to the inside and make it 3 wide. Not enough room to do so, but that's going to be what this is all about. It's working with the closest person, but knowing that that person is probably going to turn on you, you're going to use somebody up at some point. It's no more take and a lot more give than what you're going to be seeing right now. So these guys are going to be going at it. A couple of connection issues continue for the 92 of Rod Mitten. I'm hearing his car is having some problems and he'll be black flagged from race control. So that's going to take him outside of the top 10. You'd hate to see an issue like that be a factor in all of this. Josh Ball, though, things are looking good. He used the inside on row 2 to go up the inside. He's 2nd right now behind Shane McEachin.
Yeah, he is right now, and looks like DeMerchant's all by his lonesome up there. He's got the 22 pushing him. Now Peterson's can maybe look back to try and help those guys, but Ron Thompson's really the only one up there on that outside who's been consistently working with DeMerchant. It looks like Peterson's staying on the bottom, trying to get a little bit of draft, maybe trying to get a run so he can push those 2 up towards the lead, but I agree that Peterson, I think, is going to try and ditch the 22 every chance he gets so he can push the 42. So those 2 can run together. But another guy who that caution absolutely saved was that 24 of Josh Hanner. He's back in this. He's in 9th right now, which is exactly where he needs to be. He needs to be in that top pack.
And we go on board with Ron Thompson's machine as he finds himself in the middle of a whole lot that's going on here up at the front of the field, trying to find a way through, trying to find the best way through if he wants to be able to get up to the front of the field here and back in a good position in order to try to get the win, because you're starting to run out of time. There's no more setting things up and getting in a pretty position and trying to make it a logical charge to the front. Right now, you're going to take what you can get, and that is the inside lane showing some muscle. They're all over each other on the bottom, not giving the outside much of a chance. Peterson and DeMerchant are going to get together, but they're the only 2 up there. Can they be as fast with just those 2 in comparison to an inside line that has about 4 times as many cars? We'll see. They're hooked up and they're charging. Watch for the side draft, already up to 4.
Yeah, and look right now off of turn 2 as that top side gets a little bit of a run. Watch for the 48 to jump out. He's not going to do it yet, but that's going to be the move that he's going to need to do. We've seen it week after week after week when that guy in that 2nd spot on the bottom line will jump out in front of that top line, get the push, and take the lead. So Josh Ball's just got to time it at the correct time. And right now with 23 laps to go this time by, obviously not the time he wants to force the issue. He's just content currently to run behind that 28 of Shane McEachin right now. Shane McEachin, we haven't talked much about him. He's been the leader for the past 20 or 25 laps or so. So good job by the 28 so far tonight. He's leading a ton of laps.
And we know how aggressive DeMerchant and Peterson can get. I don't want to talk about just them, but again, Seth is in a spot where He's above the cut line into tonight. Not by a lot, but he's above the cut line. So if it comes down to it on the last lap, they may not force that three wide that they normally would because they don't need to. That means that if you want it and you want it more badly than they do, then you might be able to just do something about that. We'll see, though. We talk about Ball. We talk about Peterson and Merchant. We also mentioned that the 24 machine, Hanner, was up in a conversation. He has since fallen back a little bit, but still holds seventh at the moment. After he went to the outside, it didn't work. He's behind Matt Quick on the bottom of the racetrack. That throws now 4 to 5 of the chase names inside of the top 10. And this time by, we're going to be inside of the final 20 laps of this race. Good on fuel to the end. Cautions and the pace of this race are going to dictate the rest of it. But Shane McEachin, that Husky machine, has been looking pretty good out in front of the field right now. He's trying to win a nice super speedway feature.
Yeah, he is. And another guy up there that we haven't really talked about much tonight, Matt Quick in that number 89 Giftmobile. You can see the green rims, and I won't talk much about his sponsors because I don't want to get us muted or anything. But, you know, he's been having a great night, and he's another one of these guys. You know, maybe like a Rod Flagg, who's just not had the greatest of luck at all this whole season, just been caught up in a lot of stuff. But he's up there right now when it counts, and he wants to take home a trophy because, of course, you remember, these guys get a trophy, and I want a trophy, Andy. Even if I'm not run for championship, I want a trophy.
Well, you better get out there and jump in next season and get out of the booth, and we'll see you out on the racetrack. You know, you can get around a super speedway, so... that would be fun to see. So, but yeah.
I'm not going behind the wheel. Guys, for those that tuned in a couple of seasons ago, we did that once on a Friday night, and it did not end well. So, if you weren't tuning in a couple of seasons ago on iSuper Speedway, I encourage you to dig through the LSRTV YouTube and find that. But I won't be getting behind the wheel anymore on Friday nights.
So you tried it. Tried to get that trophy. It just didn't work, huh?
No, I got about 30 laps in and got wrecked by a teammate. So I'll leave it at that.
That's why we jumping talk in like there, you know, throwing Evan under the bus, saying if Evan goes back on the track, they'll clear the track so that he doesn't hit anything. So that doesn't bode well for you there, Evan.
I'll take a trophy one way or another. Nonetheless, again, you know, you look at plate track racing on the sim, but again, it's always fun to look at the nature of this series because, you know, we talk about RSR stuff. You get super speedways a couple of times. You try to just get through them. Oh, caution, though. Problems behind your race leaders. Problems in turns 3 and 4 and into the outside wall they go. And spinning to a stop will come Jason Altman's. That may be it for his championship hopes. After he got hit by the 83, it looked like maybe a little bit of a push up the hill by Ramon Evans. Altman's gets hooked by the 4 then, and into the outside wall they go. And I'm not sure if Jason Altman's has that quick fix sitting. That car is absolutely junked, and he'll go pit side.
That's a tough break right there. And you know what? I think it started with net code. Looked like the 51 went right into the 4, you know, inside the car, actually. So it didn't start off really well there, but it looked like it started with a net code and obviously didn't end well for Jason Altman's, and his opportunity for a championship might be out of the question here this evening. Looked like he maybe still had his quick repair left, but obviously the laps are winding down here. Only 18 to go when they cross the line this time. So under that last caution, it looked like the 48 was looking like he was saving fuel. So I think you might see the leaders come down this time, and just to know that they are good till the end. So we'll see what happens here. As looks like the 48's going to head down pit road, possibly. No, he's going to stay out with track position. He's going to have to save some fuel, I believe.
I think he wanted to, but with nobody else staying out, that would drop him so far back that I think the track position is a little bit more important than a good handling race car. So he's going to stay out there. He'll tough through it. And all of these guys are going to decide what ends this race at Talladega for the final time at Talladega on the Season 5 campaign. Daytona going to be the site of next Friday night season finale. 6 drivers going to be cut down to 3, less than 20 laps to go. And the Altman's Designs 351 will take this opportunity under the caution flag. Step away for one final time during racing conditions to go LSRTV nonstop. In the meantime, though, Shane McEachin leads at lap 66 of 82. He'll be out in front for a 15-lap-to-go restart when we come back.
Trucking has always been a part of me. It started years ago when my dad and granddad were hauling vegetables to market in Liverpool. The family immigrated to Canada in the late 60s and settled near Alliston, Ontario. I bought my first truck in 1982 and Mercer Trucking was born. Today, Mercer Trucking has over 50 trucks and terminals in Toronto and Los Angeles. Our storage facilities at both terminals can handle any size of distribution needs throughout North America. We service the continental U.S., including Hawaii and Alaska. We run over 120,000 miles per month and some of the best equipment on the road today. We specialize in less than truckload shipments, show freight. We do rush team service deliveries and haul your refrigerated or heated product. Our regular team service from Canada to California is second to none, and our staff and drivers are among the best in the business. I'm proud of our people and what they can achieve. Trucking is in my blood, it's my livelihood, and it's what I do best.
Once its sights are set, nothing can stop the ferocious lion from capturing its prey. Relying on keen senses, lions search patiently before striking with alarming speed.
Wait for it.
Gotcha, Mr. Piece of Rubbish. He is truly the master of his environment. Do good. Be a lion.
We're back live at Talladega, and one thing that happened there, we talked about Josh Ball faking out of the pit lane. You'll see a replay right now. Ronnie Wofford coming down pit side. We talked about everybody faking out. Well, Brandon Chiburco drove up alongside him, and when Wofford tried to fake out of the pit lane entry, turned back up, and those guys made contact. And now Ronnie Wofford, a championship hopeful, 4 points below the cut line into tonight, is going to have to do the final 15 laps with a damaged car.
Damaged car and a lot of traffic to go through, so tough break right there for Wofford. Right now showing on the grid in that 13th position, so I mean, he doesn't have a lot of track to make up, but with a damaged car, it could definitely hurt your chances if you're the one trying to lead a pack or lead a line up to the front. So he might have to rely a little bit too much on some help from some other drivers, but if anybody can get it done with a damaged race car on a plate track, it would definitely be that 7 machine.
And it's a tough break for both of them, but again, more so the short end of the straw for the championship competitor to get in that mix there and get torn up. But he's not that badly torn up, Cisco. Based on what we've seen, Josh Ball has damage. We've seen other guys have damage. I don't think it's really slowed them down all that much. I think his bigger problem is the fact that he's in 13th position.
Yeah, and I mean, we're seeing, you know, guys like Josh Hanner up there, they have a little bit of damage. I'm seeing a little bit of damage to the back end, actually, Christian Peterson. He's been up here all night. So, but I really don't think it's going to matter for Wofford as far as his driving style goes. I think he's going to be super aggressive here. He needs to be, because everyone he's racing is, with the exception of Altman's, that is, everyone he's racing is up here in, like, this top 10 group. So he's got to be aggressive here if he wants to make his way into this chase.
You have to be aggressive, but you have to have a car that crosses the start-finish line. We're not going all for broke until next week, when those three drivers that make it to the Supreme 3 round, top finisher amongst them gets the championship. You still have to be somewhat strategic in these closing laps at Talladega. We're going to take lap number 69 of 82 on the night. Puts us at 14 laps to go. Couple of restarts may still be down the road. But right now, Shade McEachin wants to walk away with the trophy. The pace car going to make the sharp left-hand turn down and away for what could be the final time on Talladega tonight. Green flag going to fly as we roll through the tri-oval into the restart zone. Back underway we go for the Altman's Designs 351. And topside, better jump. Josh Ball's got a nose at the start-finish line. Not enough of a jump, though, to jump to the bottom. McEachin going to bring it right back in the center on 1 and 2.
This might be his opportunity to get himself in the lead right now. He's got a pretty good machine, Frank Musilia, right behind him in that McDonald's board to push him to the lead here, and we'll see if he can be able to get it done or what. or what's going to happen, but Josh Ball, he needs to be the leader in one of these lines, and right now he's got the outside line. The question is just going to be, is he going to have enough help behind him to get him to push him out ahead of Shane McEachin?
There's no doubt that if you want to pass somebody, you have to go topside. Nobody really makes passes on the bottom. You need a push. You got to get down and long. He's got a seasoned veteran behind him and Frank Baselli, which is interesting because Frank, one of the drivers that entered this ice super chase before being eliminated, who was looking to be a two-time champion. Nobody has ever won the iSuperSpeedway.com Racing Series Championship more than once. In four seasons, we've had four different champions. Josh Ball, the only remaining driver eligible to pick up his second championship this season, and he's got another past champion behind him. That's a pretty good pusher, I'd say, to have behind you, the 94 Basilia, trailed by the 89 of Matt Quick. That outside may be hurting, though, because of the fact that there's only three of them up there. Everybody else has migrated down to the bottom.
And everybody else includes that 42 of Seth the Merchant and that 24 of Josh Hanner. You look back, Rodney Wofford's on the bottom. They're all back up here. Wofford didn't take him too long. He's restarted on the inside there, so he's able to make it work on the inside line. But now that outside line is starting to fall back. No one really up there to make a run at it right now. I think it's too early. Wofford says, no, I don't think it is. He's going to jump to the high side with the rookie Pacini. He's going to jump with him up to that outside. They're going to try and make something happen here.
I mean, you talked about Jason Oatman's being back in the pack in 31st position. Oh, now three wide for the race lead to the inside. It's Seth the Merchant, topside Christian Peterson, and Shane McEachin in the middle. Peterson going to get shuffled in a line. Caution now behind your leaders. Ron Thompson around in turn three. It appears the 22, the only driver involved in this one, at least the only driver to get some heavy damage, and that looks like just the big check up into the corner, and the 22 is the one that got spin out of line. He got really junked, but I don't think anybody else got a whole lot of damage, if any, because he went over most of them after the hard lick in turn three.
Yeah, that's a pretty interesting wreck right there. Enough height as you look at the replay, and he literally just went above everyone right there. So that was kind of an interesting wreck right there, and probably a little bit of neck code for some of those guys driving underneath them, but tough break right there for the 22. He was having a good run. We saw him running up front in that lead pack there about mid-race there in the top eight, so just an unfortunate break right there for him, making a little contact. Probably a little neck code involved in that also, but Ron Thompson, his night looks like it's going to be over as he takes the virtual tow back to pit road.
So the point that I was going to start to make there with the problems that we've seen really recently for Jason Altman's is he's in 30th position. He came into tonight above the cut line by 8 points. So if you're 22nd or so, you're going to tie him. You have to be 18th or so to be Josh Hanner and Rodney Wofford, as they run now, to be in a spot to pass him. DeMerchant's doing exactly what he needs, but if Josh Ball doesn't win this race, it would be Seth the Merchant advancing, at least the way it looks now. And then it would be really a drag race, a toss-up between Rodney Wofford and Josh Hanner. Hanner is fourth, Wofford is 10th. They both entered here with the same amount of points. So whichever one of those two finishes in front of each other will get the spot. And right now, that looks like it'll be the P3 that you need to make the cut line. So Wofford was starting to get nervous. He was looking to the outside. We mentioned how everybody had gone down to the bottom, Cisco, and you mentioned, well, Josh Ball's down there too, because right now he can ride on the bottom of the racetrack at the moment, rather than Josh Hanner. Ball's the one that's got to get going, but Hanner can ride, Wofford can't. P10's a whole lot better than the situation that Jason Oatman's is in, but that 7 machine with this restart coming inside of the final 10 laps to go, I think it'll be more so around 7, so there's still a chance we get one more restart, but we could get 3 laps of caution and this race would be over. I'm not looking forward to what Rodney Wofford's probably going to have to do on this restart to get up there.
And another thing to note there, they went 3 wide for the lead there, and Josh Ball had a huge run on our would-have-been leader, Shane McEachin. He ran into the back of him. You look at that nose of the 48, that's some pretty big damage. I mean, you know, I think Josh Hanner's gotten a little worse for wear, but, you know, it's, you know, minuscule things like this. We talk about Talladega, land of the 1/1000th, and, you know, It's a little bit of damage, but a little bit of damage can do a whole lot to your night if you're having to worry about the heating of that car. And that was one heck of a hit he gave the 28.
We look at the lights on top of the pace car to tell us how many laps we'll have to go. And, you know, even the difference between 6 laps to 7 laps means that a lot more different things can happen, and the strategy does change a lot. We do want to note, though, that tonight's i5 bonus is $25 with Seth Merchant, Jason Altman's Christian Peterson, Justin Anderson, or Frank Basilia make it to the end of this race across the start-finish line first. And walk away with a $25 bonus. If those five drivers don't, it'll be $30 going into next week at Daytona. We saw these guys. They thought about coming down pit road, Andy, the last time through. They elected to stay out. They were saving some fuel. It was close. Their numbers were on, but they wanted to have a little bit of extra fuel just in case. No need to have a lot extra because there's no overtime, no green-white checker in the iRacing service. But we believe now the drivers are confident that they're going to have plenty enough room in the fuel tank to be able to get to the end of this race. So fuel now, I think we can rule out of the question of being a concern.
Yeah, and that's a good thing. You'd hate to be in Josh Ball's position, and perhaps he gets into the lead here and coming to the checkered flag, he runs out of fuel. So that'd be a pretty heartbreaking way to get knocked out of the chase. So yeah, it looks as though with these extra caution laps that these guys have gotten, that good to go on fuel, and no need to worry about that. Just need to worry about out the front windshield, and hopefully you don't see another car out in front of you. That's exactly what the 48 needs.
So we're looking like we're going to be more in the range or so of getting the lights off at 75, going green at 76, and then putting us in a position to have a 7-lap shootout. Shane McEachin, Seth Merchant, Josh Ball, Josh Hanner, and Christian Peterson are your top 5 runners from the Talladega Super Speedway. Still sitting with a decent amount of drivers on the lead lap, 34 total still in this race, and well more than enough drivers to race this one out and keep it exciting, but also that's still well more than enough drivers to make some big junk late. We haven't seen the big one yet. We've seen some big licks, but we haven't seen a pileup. So I do have to say that that's not out of the question yet with 34 drivers.
Well, you just
knock on wood.
Yeah, it's over.
I should have done that before. Okay.
Yeah. Well, let's hope we didn't give the curse to the field.
We'll see, because some guys, if they get it, depends on where you're running, but a caution is going to help some guys. If Josh Ball doesn't want one because he's got to get to the race lead quick. Seth the Merchant would take a yellow. As they run right now, Josh Hanner would take a yellow. As long as you're not the yellow. And we always talk about on the long green flag runs, as the lights are now off of the pace car, guys drop back to stay out of it, and the guys up front, you know, normally you're pretty safe if you're on the front couple of rows. On these kind of restarts, inside of 10 laps to go, especially with everything that's on the line, we talk about so much stress. And the last two finishes we've had in this series have gone down the post-race reviews. It's been crazy. This is so much pressure on these guys, so much more than even we saw last season, the first time that this iSuper chase with the elimination rounds was implemented. I'd have to say that this is probably the most intense race and the most stakes in the history of this league's 5 seasons, and it's going to come down to one final restart. You're going to have like 16 rows of cars. I don't think it's safe to say that anybody is safe at this point. You just got to keep the car pointed forward and hope that you don't get hit if something happens.
Yeah, I would not want to get in the way of the 48 or the 51 or the 7. Really, any of these chase guys.
None of the chase guys.
The 42 is the only guy here I would be, you know, okay with him behind me. But the rest of these guys, I don't know, Evan.
We're going to find out. We'll have laps 76, 77, 78, 79 through 80, and then 81 and 82. That is all that is left. Again, that's still enough time to get a caution flag and get a restart, but if we go green for 3 laps and then we see a yellow, this will be a caution flag finish at Talladega. This is what you've stuck around to see. We're going to send 3 drivers home in just a couple of minutes, and the pace car going to want to get well and out of the way, making that sharp left-hand turn down to the safety of the pit lane. Shane McEachin gets set to go as we roll into the tri-oval. Got to hold the back a couple extra 100 yards until we cycle through the tri-oval to the American Ethanol Go Zone. Green flag flies in the air, back at it at Talladega. 7 laps to go.
7 laps to go, and you talk about a caution in about 3 or 4 laps, if it was to happen, would put an end to this race. Josh Ball in the 48 needs to go, and needs to go now. This is his opportunity, sitting in the third spot, right behind Shane McEachin on that bottom side. They need to get a little bit of a break, and then Josh Ball needs to get up to that outside to get around him. And down the back straightaway, though, everything looking good. Top side, a little bit of an advantage. Set the Merchant
Peterson,
to the lead.
Peterson, three
now
wide.
Now into the inside, three wide. Whoa. Here goes Peterson. He backs out of it wisely. Wow, that would have been interesting.
He did that twice already tonight, and that is just find a hole and stick it in there. And Josh Ball, there was no way that he was letting that happen. Contact for the race lead. McKeachy don't push up. He'll get into the door. Set the Merchant. Going to go to the top spot on track. Josh Hanner going to follow through behind in second. He can't get cleared down low. Seth, though, not going to drop down to the inside either. Now he does and leaves the 24 topside.
Hanner's he has help on the way. Obviously, Vasily is right behind him, but behind them, Wofford, Cassini, and up that top line. They've got a huge run. Here they come, right up to the back bumper of the 94 of Vasily. They're going to get a great run down the back here. Is it going to matter? I guess we'll find out. But Kitchen goes to the high side. Does he want to spoil the party here? He's going to go to the high side, pushed by Hanner as they come through 3 and 4.
If it finishes the way they sit now, Seth the Merchant with a win would go on, and that 24 to Hanner gets the only spot in on points. But you see two cars behind the 24? That's the 7 of Ronnie Wofford. They are tied on points. Whoever finishes in front of each other gets that ticket into the round of 3 at Daytona next week. So much on the line. But now topside, Shane McKeachin, he jumps out in front of the 24 to Hanner, and he had a nose at the start-finish line. Inside, going to power through on the bottom. But for that 48 of Josh Ball, Andy, he can't go anywhere. He can't go to the high side of the racetrack to try to pass. He's boxed in on the bottom.
Yeah, he needs to hope that top side gets pushed back just a little bit so he can time the run and get out in front of Shane McKeachin and have an opportunity to get out ahead of Seth the Merchant. Right now might be his chance as they power through 3 and 4 right now, starting to pull away from the 28, but he's going to battle back off the corner. Top side, this is what they do on the top side. Battled hard, and there's trouble behind him. Spinning cars going down to the apron. Hopefully we
still
can
green.
Stay green. So far, so good. They're still double wide for the lead at the line.
No caution. They spin down. They're below the yellow line. The wrecked cars are going to get down pit side. The 4 car, the one that takes the major brunt of that damage. No caution. We stay green. At 4 laps to go, battle for the race lead continues, but they're stuck too wide. It seems funny to say that, but because nobody's getting clear, nobody can go anywhere. They're packed so tight. Basilia looks at the bottom. He jumps back out topside, but for the two guys that where they sit right now, they can't do anything. You go on board with Frank Basilia. For Josh Ball and Ronnie Wofford, there's nothing that they can do at the moment. They're stuck where they run, and where they run is not good enough. Caution flag is out. Problems behind your race leader in turns 3 and 4. Yellow flag is out. Donnie Giratano's number 2 Chevrolet is around after he wrecked for 21st and 22nd position, and the yellow flag will fly. Seth the Merchant, set to be your provisional race winner. That would punch his ticket into the Supreme 3. Josh Ball in 3rd, not enough. Josh Hanner in P5 would be the provisional 3rd place finisher in the round of 6 and would join DeMerchant and Peterson in the round of 3. And this one will end under the caution flag. And we talked about how Ball and Wofford, they just didn't have enough time to go anywhere. They were stuck. Maybe if we go green for these additional 3 laps, Andy, they get a shot at it. The cards and the stars really don't line up for them tonight. It appears that it'll be Seth the Merchant and Josh Hanner moving on to fight for a championship next Friday. Results are unofficial.
And this is so why they need to implement green white checkered.
I'm on board.
For this reason.
Yep.
Green white checkered.
I agree. I mean, and there's races where, you know, you come down to some of the entities and, you know, not really in the plate track stuff, but you get to a race and you get a bunch of cautions at the end. And then, you know, some people argue, well, we don't want to extend it again. The green white checker is still a relatively new concept to NASCAR. If you look at its history, I'd agree that I'd like to see some green white checkers. I'll tell you who else would sign the petition with us, Andy. Josh Ball and Ronnie Wofford. Those are two guys that would agree. Unfortunately, there
Altman?
Is no overtime. Altman's would agree. He got in that accident again. We talked about a little bit earlier on. He's been stuck at about P25, though, for a lot of the race. I'm not sure what his hopes were. But, you know, it's just you hate. And we've been spoiled, I think, the last 2 weeks. And I know you don't like to see controversy every week. But, I mean, the last 2 finishes have been just so incredible that You know, I think we were due a caution flag finish at once, and it was still a crazy last restart there. But everybody was going so hard that they weren't spreading out. They were just as close to each other when that caution came out four laps after the restart than they were when they went back and took the green flag. So that was everybody going hard. I'm sure they would have gotten a little bit physical for it if we got down to those final two laps and didn't get an opportunity to do so, but still a very exciting finish.
Yeah, it's exciting to watch them go 55 miles an hour to the finish. No, listen, you know, I don't know. I'm a little upset because I would have loved to have seen how this thing really shook out. But I look down just at the end of pit road, and you got a fire truck and an ambulance that have lights that blink, but we can't have green light checkers. I'm sorry. That upsets me.
Dynamic tracks as well, a new thing that has come to the sim.
Well, listen, dynamic tracks is cool. I like that, and it affects the racing. I'm fine with that. But seriously, birds that fly and
airplanes.
Lights that blink on cars that don't even move. I mean, come on.
No green white checkers in the most recent build, and at least not in the near future from what we know at the moment. And it's not going to help any of these guys unless a new build comes out in about the next minute and 30 seconds or so. The white flag going to fly alongside the yellow this time through. 28 drivers, it looks like, are going to cross the start-finish line on the same lap as your leaders. Championship hopeful set the merchant. Entered tonight four points, really, above Josh Hanner for the final transfer spot. He wins. He'll get that automatic ticket into the final round, join Christian Peterson as the number one and the number two seeds, and he'll pick up the $25 i5 bonus for winning tonight after getting a top five finish in the last round at Talladega as well before he went on the Christmas and New Year's break. Josh Ball's number 48 was 18 points behind the cut line. It's not going to be enough, although a P3 is a very good run, and he had a good run going in the opening race to this round of six. That's not going to be enough for him. Josh Hanner's P4 should be enough to give him the only spot in on points. Behind him, Rodney Wofford going to come up. Well, he's four spots behind Hanner, so it'll probably put him about 4 points short of making that cut. And then we talked about the big problems for the guys behind, mainly Jason Altman, who had a bad night to get everything started off with. Things, needless to say, did not go his favor. After, again, he was doing good. This was a scenario where all of our chase guys were up there. Not meant to be for him, though, in an accident. Didn't have enough time to get back up.
Yeah, and you know what? Listen, I may be upset about greenway checkers, but I put that behind me. Listen, Josh Ball did everything he possibly could. He ran up front all night long once he started in the back. He started 31st, worked his way up to the front. He was there. He was there when it mattered. So, listen, he did everything he could. And obviously, he boxed in like he was. You were not making a pass unless you went below the yellow line, which wouldn't have gotten anyway, but no, great job by all these guys and all the chasers. Listen, somebody's got to go home, right? So we will not have a repeat winner, so it will be a new first-time winner in the Cup Series next week. So that's also a pretty exciting thing for the series.
And Shane McEachin, great run there. He kind of spoiled the whole party for everyone. Not a chaser, but he did a great job tonight.
Yeah, led a ton of laps he did too, so. Yep, good job by all these guys. It was a good race, a very good race.
It'll finish, though, at 81 miles an hour. Checkered flag, Seth the Merchant. Welcome to the Supreme 3. The championship possibilities are now still there for Seth the Merchant. The win will guarantee himself a spot in the Supreme 3 after his teammate won. Just one round to go, and that is going to be a stacked field going forward to into the round of three. We believe that it is going to be Josh Hanner joining them. However, before we talk to any of the drivers and anything along those lines, we'll step away, wait for the iSuper Speedway officials to confirm all the results, and then we'll come back and talk to some of our top finishers with the iSuper Speedway post-race show on LSR-TV. Back from Talladega in a moment. You're watching LSR-TV's coverage of the iSuperSpeedway.com racing series, iSuper Chase on iRacing Live. The wrap-up from Talladega coming back in just a minute. We're back live at the virtual Talladega Super Speedway, where the round of six on the ICE Super Speedway Season 5 ICE Super Chase calendar draws to a close. The Superior 6 is now the Supreme 3, with the conclusion of tonight's Altman's Designs 351. We still await the official results, but we believe it'll be Christian DePeterson, Seth the Merchant, and Josh Hanner battling for a championship next Friday night live on LSR-TV and iRacing Live. In the meantime, though, we'll talk to our top three finishers from tonight's event, and with that comes a P3 for the 48 of Josh Ball. A very strong result, a result that we've expected out of that 48 car all season long. But with that being said, Andy, still not enough to give that 48 enough, we believe, to jump over that line, and it's going to be the end of the road, at least championship wise tonight for Josh Ball.
Yeah, I am down here on pit road with the driver of the number 48 Lowe's Chevrolet. And Josh, I wasn't supposed to interview you, but it was a good run. It was a strong finish. You did everything in your power, except the only way I think for you to get up to the front would have been to take some people out. So other than that, we know that's not the way you drive. It was a strong effort starting 31st, driving your way all the way up to the front. You were in that lead pack of eight cars there around that halfway point. I'm sure you would have liked to seen it go green from there, but overall you got to be pretty stoked, even though that the race 3 weeks ago kind of put you out of contention. You had to either win or get out, and you did everything under your power here tonight to try to get the win. Just didn't happen.
Yeah, you know, we raced as hard as we could all season. We did pretty good. You know, we finished first at the end of regular season in the champion and the points lead. So pretty confident that the 48 car is strong. Hell of a season. Did good out there last week. There was, or well, 3 weeks ago there was pretty unfortunate events on cars being suspended, not suspended, and then resets this week. Whatever happened. You know, I can't go back and be the one to change it. So anyway, it was an interesting night out there. We did the best we could, and we didn't even use our quick repair, even though I had some damage at the time, and I wasn't really sure what to do. But you're right, yeah. If I would have tried to get up in front of Shane or anything there in the last couple laps, I would have probably wrecked us all, so that wouldn't have been the smartest move. But
well, long season, obviously. We still got next week, and they're going to crown a champion. It won't be you this season. However, it would be pretty sweet to steal the party and steal the win from all these guys, right?
Well, yeah, definitely. I'm going to go out there and definitely try to win. That's for sure a goal. You know, lucky enough to win a championship even at that. You know, there's 43 guys, or 62 now, I think, in next season that are going to be out there, and every one of them is just as good as the next. So, you know, to win, be able to win a championship alone is awesome. And, you know, we got another race win this season. So it was actually two race wins this season. So it was definitely overall a good season. Still disappointing not being able to go on to defend the championship, but we'll have another champion. You know, I think it's Seth the Merchant, Christian Peterson, or I think Josh Hanner is the other person that's going to be in. So we'll see. But you know, Shane McEachin, good job for the win tonight. It definitely came down to the last moment there under the caution. So good win. We're all trying out there, so I hope it was a good show at least.
It was a good show, and obviously a little bitter taste in your mouth, but you can seal it off next week with a win. Steal it from these guys, steal their thunder. But Josh, congratulations on a strong season. The championship's not in the picture, but we got one more week to settle the score and get another win in the victory column. So looking forward to that. Sponsor shout outs. Who helps you get the Lowe's machine up to the front?
You know, I got to thank Altman's Designs tonight for putting the paint scheme on the car. It looks really, really nice out there. So actually kind of inspired me for next season on what to do. So otherwise, obviously Lowe's, I got to thank them. They've been on the car ever since the first season. So Lowe's, Cobalt, everybody out there, Brandon, Frank, Shane, whoever else I'm forgetting. I know you're out there, James Plesky. So good job tonight, guys, and hopefully we'll be able to get the 48 in victory lane next week and go out there and hopefully win the championship next year.
All right, one more thing for you, and I won't let you comment on it, but next week you only get one interview, and it better be the victory lane. Otherwise, it better be on a tow truck. How about that?
That's a good idea. The 48, first or last next week. I'll definitely wreck it if not. So
there you go. Well, congratulations, Josh, on a good season. Third place finish, and we'll see you next week.
Thanks, Andrew. We'll talk to you later.
All right. I think Evan has caught up. He's talked with some the race officials over here at iSuper Speedway, and I believe they made a decision on actually who won this race. So, Evan, what happened?
Yeah, well, we walked away thinking Seth DeMerchant was going to be the winner. He was scored by iRacing as the winner. However, if you look back to the moment of caution when the lights go on the pace car, the outside lane was in front, and that means that Shane McEachin is your winner of the Oatman's Designs 351. So the 42, there's no rear tires left on it because Seth the Merchant's been celebrating, but he's your second place finisher, and Cisco Scaramouche is going to be caught up with him.
And I have caught up with Seth down here on pit road, and Seth, I mean, you know, we're looking at the results right now. It's not what you wanted, and, you know, it's a tough break for you, but it looks like we're going to have a little mic trouble right here. There we go. Got his mic working now. But Seth, looks like you're going to get scored second here. Talk about your race, though.
Just points racing, you know. We were only in by four over Rodney, so had to do what we had to do there and just ride around. And we got in the position there late in the race to make the move for the lead, and Kosh came out just at the wrong time within seconds and second though, but we made the chase for the next round, so we'll be battling for the championship next week.
Well, we've seen you and your teammate have been running strong all season, but next week it's, you know, you and your teammate are both in this thing. Do you work with him or do you try and win the race?
I think we'll work together for most of the race, and then once we get down to the end we'll just settle it out and see who comes home with the win. You know, we'll probably be leaving each other and not wanting to work with each other, because every spot's going to be important next week to see who's the championship. Hopefully it's one of us. It'll be pretty cool.
Well, you know, going into that, you haven't, what's your mindset going in? Because obviously, you know, obviously the teammate whole situation, but going in, we're going back to Daytona. We've had this week off. We did see a couple different things happen that we don't normally see. Some guys getting loose off pit road and a couple different things. What's the mindset kind of going into next week?
I'm just going to try to play it safe for the probably first half of the race. And then after that, if I still have that reset, I'm just going to go for it. And if I get wrecked, then I have something, you know, I can fall back on and I can still have a chance and see what happens.
All right, Seth, well, you get the second place tonight. You're into the next round of the chase. Who gets it done for you and your team?
P-Money Designs and Brandon Smizer for spotting me again tonight. And I got to thank Rod for putting on the league and you guys for broadcasting.
All right, well, that's Seth the Merchant. He's going to finish second here tonight, and he's moving on into the chase next week. But one person who came in and has spoiled the party now officially, I believe Evan Pasoka has caught up with our big winner, Shane McEachin.
Yeah, they backed the 42 out, and they brought the number 28 in. So Shane McEachin, he does spoil the party and gets the checkered flag tonight at the Talladega Super Speedway. After an official review, he is deemed the winner of the Oatman's Designs 351. Shane, congratulations. Not a conventional way of getting the W, having to wait and find it out about 5 minutes later, but I'm sure you won't object to it. Started 19th, you end up walking away on top of the pile, but for you to be there, and the guy in front of you is in the chase, the guy behind you is in the chase, the guy behind him is in the chase, and the guy behind him is in the chase. It's you and all of the chase guys. That's some pretty good company to be racing around. I'm sure you felt like they weren't giving you much room, and you were just hanging on. You got the job done. How'd you do it?
Yeah, well, we set ourselves up good from the start with the first green flag stop we had. Frank and I, we had great pit stops, and were able to come out and lead, and, you know, Seth's great. He's always up there, and, you know, I knew he was going to be tough to beat, and, you know, he cleared me that one time, and from then on, I knew from second place it was going to be tough to get around him, and, you know, it just, We got lucky. I don't know. I think we might could have got around him eventually if it had went green. But heck of a race. I mean, I got to thank Josh. Josh gave me a great push there that put me in that spot. And, you know, just a crazy race. It was fun, though.
It's exciting nonetheless. We've been talking really a whole lot about the championship, but we always, you know, talk about the spoilers and guys that try to come in here and take away the thunder, per se, from all of those championship guys and, you know, get the job done and put up a fight for it. A very good run for you here tonight to get that W, and it's a well-deserved win. What has it been like, though, these last couple of weeks? I know we've had a lot of time off, but racing in this iSuper Chase, whilst not being one of the drivers that advanced into this round of six after you made it to the round of 10, did anything change for you when we went over to these next, I guess now the last two races after not making it through the round at Daytona, or was it really just business as usual for you and your team?
A little mix of both. I mean, we, you know, we had nothing to lose here, so we definitely went for the win. You know, the reset rule changed this week, and, you know, we raced the whole time, and, you know, we never used it, but, you know, it's kind of bittersweet with knowing that if, you know, I made an error myself early and took myself out of the chase, but had I not done that, then, you know, this right here would have possibly transferred me to the final round.
And then luck comes for you again in this round as opposed to that prior, but you did a very good job nonetheless. And it's a statement for you to roll forward into next season and say that we're going to target that iSuper Chase and try to once again fight for a championship. We're not quite done, though. We're not quite set to roll on to season six. There's still one race left, and the stakes are going to be oh so high into the winner-take-all event at Daytona. Another race, though, that you could walk in and get one more trophy out of it. I know I just asked you the question, but I'll ask it again. Going into that race now, with everything being considered, do you, and I mean I'm talking about you and the 33 other guys that aren't those three guys battling for the championship, Daytona any different for you? Because, you know, you kind of, I'd understand, I guess, the idea that you want to let them do the thing, but at the same time, it's the last race of the year, it's a big endurance event, you want to get the win, and getting that win will give you a huge boost of confidence going forward into the next season. So while you guys, I'm sure, want to let them do the thing, I don't think you're going to just give it to them.
Yeah, I mean, we're going to win. If they want a championship, they're going to have to earn it.
The mentality you got to take, well, hey, you went door to door with these guys tonight. You didn't back down, and you showed why you deserve to get that 28 into the iSuper Chase to begin with. So congratulations, Shane, on the victory. Sponsors and shout-outs, who do you want to thank for making this possible?
Yeah, like I said, I want to thank the guys. You know, there's several that's worked with us tonight. Seth worked with me. He, you know, helped me stay out front as well. Josh Ball, Hanner, Brandon, and Frank. Also, want to give a shout out to Jason Oatmans for the paint scheme. You know, it's satisfying to win the race with his car, being he sponsored it. And thank you guys.
We appreciate you sticking around and chatting with us, and you had to wait a little bit to get confirmation on that one, but you are the winner at Talladega. So enjoy the hardware, sir. We'll see you next Friday night at Daytona while we wrap up this season.
Thank you.
Again, that is tonight's winner upon an official review, Shane McEachin. Although he'll be scored on the top of the screen at second place, he is the winner, and that's how close it was. Take a look on your screen now. Again, at the time of the caution flag, iRacing scored Seth Demerchant as your race winner, but if you look at that still image, iRacing can be slowed down to a single shot frame by frame, and once the yellow lights were activated around the racetrack, that is where the top two drivers were running side by side on the racetrack. It was indeed Shane McEachin in front of Seth Demerchant when they came across the start-finish line at the end of the race. Therefore, the 28 machine is going to be corrected and be scored as the official race winner in the post-race review by Race Control. You can't cut it much closer than that, guys.
Yeah, it's a very close finish there. I mean, I have it up myself, and it's an inch. Maybe 2 inches. That's so close, but you can back it up frame by frame, and you know, you look at the pace car, lights on, track is lights on the first time, and it's close, but you can see it, and Shane McEachin able to get it done here at Talladega.
And Seth's on the bottom, so if that's like a tenth of a second later, the 42's in front. I mean, it is just so close. at the end of all of that, Shane McEachin ends up walking away as the winner, and the official results come in on the points, guys, and Christian Peterson advanced with the win. Seth the Merchant will still advance, although he does not get the win. That would have sucked if he was not in that spot, because we have seen so much drama late in these races lately. I'm happy to see that that's not going to be the case tonight. So Seth the Merchant is going to be scored in second. He will still advance, though, 10 points above the cut line. Josh Hanner will advance 3 points above the cut line. Ronnie Watford will fall short. So will Josh Ball, and so will Jason Altman. So those are the drivers that are not going to make it. And we'll see Christian Peterson, Seth the Merchant, and Joshua Hanner fighting for a championship in Daytona next Friday night in Indy. Like you said, we mentioned that Josh was the only driver eligible to get a second championship. We're going to have our fifth different champion in just 5 seasons of iSuperSpeedway.com competition, with these 3 guys going into it looking for their first.
Yeah, and you know what that means is that just means the competition here is so stout. You got, like you said, on a regular basis, 40-some cars that come in here week after week with the opportunity to win, and to break it all down at the end of the season to just 3 guys, it just shows you that, you know, with each season, the competition's just so strong that it can be anybody. And, you know, for the 4 guys that have won it before, whoever's going to win it now, it just shows how hard it is to get it done. And so it makes it that much more gratifying when you do win the championship. So I'm sure whoever wins it next week will feel the same, and it'll be just as hard for them to try to repeat the following season.
And it's not going to get any easier from here as this championship continues to evolve. Again, it's the second season with this iSuper Chase elimination style format, and it is providing as much, if not more, excitement than what we saw in the Season 4 installment just about 6 or 7 months ago from where we sit now. So that's it. 17 races down, just 1 to go. Bonus points don't matter. Laps led don't matter. It is whoever finishes highest in the running order of the 3 drivers that have advanced to the Supreme 3 round that get the title. It's just like the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series is. And I think that, you know, we talked about this in our iSuper Chase preview show, but Cisco, before we step away, I think that a lot of people still don't like the Chase format in the Cup Series, but I think for how much of a crapshoot plate track racing always is, to kind of have that transferred over to the points bracket as well, I think it's fair. It's accurate. I mean, these races are so unpredictable that not only do you have to be a good driver, and Christian Peterson, Seth Merchant, and Josh Hanner fit that bill 100%, but sometimes you got to have a little luck on your side. Tonight, that luck was on Shane McEachin's side as he's handed the victory, but I cannot wait for Daytona. Although it's next Friday, it'll probably feel like that 3-week break we just got off of.
Well, I mean, Evan, you're going to look and people, you know, Seth the Merchant, I think he really likes his Chase format. I think Peterson does, and I think Hanner does as well. I think those are the only 3 guys right now who really like this Chase format. I think everyone else isn't so sure on it, if you know what I mean. But you know, it breeds a different type of racing. It really does. It's, you know, a lot more focus on that finishing, on, you know, being in that constant top 5. And, you know, even we see guys, you know, who are always in the top 5, you just have to work that little bit harder, and it really brings out who can go out there and just bring home, you know, the best finish they possibly can. We talk about consistent driving over a season. This really, it focuses more on consistency up front, whereas, you know, you'll see in maybe another Chase format, consistency just in general. So personally, I'm not the biggest fan of this Chase format. I think it brings a lot of excess drama and puts a lot of pressure on these drivers, but it makes for some exciting racing. It makes for finishes like what we've seen so far this whole season. So, you know, in the end, I think we know we're going to Daytona. We got 3 guys who are going to go out there and race their heart out to win this championship, and you can't really ask for much more.
Blood, sweat, and tears is what's on the menu for next Friday night at the Virtual World Center of Racing. Andy, tonight, exciting 3rd week in a row. The race has gone down to a post-finish review. A little bit less drama involved in this one, as it doesn't alter the ultimate outcome. Tough break for a lot of our Chase guys. Heartbreak. We'll see the same thing again next week. But next week, we're going to crown a 5th champion.
Yeah, and this is going to put the fire under the butts of guys who didn't make the Supreme 3. So look for some of those guys, like Josh Ball said, you know, flat out go for the win. Jason Altman's, I'm sure he's in the same position. Frank Busilia, you know, the guys that made the chase but just couldn't make it to the end. So, you know, the top three guys are going to be battling out for the championship, and ultimately it's just basically who finishes in front of the other. But, you know, those other guys I mentioned, they're going to want to end the season on a high note and get that win.
It was an excited race at Talladega, and we won't return here for about a month and a half, because once our season wraps up next week at Daytona, Season 6 gets underway the following week with Daytona Speed Weeks. It's nonstop Friday night action on LSR TV, and we hope that not only are you going to be with us next Friday night, but throughout the 2016 racing calendar. Frank Busilia was the Season 1 champion. Brandon Ciburco won it in Season 2. Rod Flagg won the third installment, and Josh Ball, defending champion, won it in Season 4. Three names, one of them is going to join that caliber list of drivers of an iSuperSpeedway.com series champion, and that'll be determined next Friday night. So until we get to the Daytona International Speedway, we bid you farewell from Talladega for the final race here on the Season 5 campaign. Congratulations to Shane McEachin, your winner at Talladega of the Altman's Designs 351, and congratulations as well. Christian Peterson, Seth the Merchant, and Josh Hanner. They'll race it out at Daytona for the finale in Florida 400. It'll be next Friday night only on LSR TV, the voice of sim racing. We hope to see you then. Good night.